In this video, I'm going to talk about the 2021 series of the CIE. Now, I'm going to talk about the MC questions highlighted, okay, by the examiner reports. Okay, that means they have high chance to appear in your coming exam. So I think, okay, if you have limited time to study, you should watch, okay, all these relevant videos about, okay, all the question types, okay, all the common mistake highlighted by, okay, by the examiners. Okay, we will start with the paper one, okay, the paper one. That means for both A level or AS level candidates, okay, this video is suitable for you, okay. So let's take a look. The first question I would like to highlight, or the first question highlighted by the authority, is question 17. Now, question 17 asks about, okay, the subsidy per unit, okay, the subsidy per unit. As you can see, from S1 to S2, okay, here, right, this one would be the per unit subsidy. This one would be the per unit subsidy. So the answer would strictly goes to C. Very, very easy. But still, a lot of candidates make a mistake. Say, for example, they pick option D. Why would they pick option D? Because they think that the change in price would equal to the per unit subsidy, which is wrong. Which is wrong, okay? Because, think about it, the subsidy per unit, okay, would equals to, you know, the consumer burden plus the producer burden. Now that's why, okay, in usual case, the per unit subsidy should be greater than that of the change in price. Okay, unless there are, you know, extreme case like the, okay, related to the elasticities. Otherwise, the per unit subsidy, okay, must be greater than the change in price. Okay, now, if you get this question wrong, okay, that means, okay, you might not, okay, fully understand this topic or concepts. Now, question 18 is a very straightforward, okay, I would say, is national defense, okay, is included in all the versions of the textbook, okay, all the notes in every single school, okay, they talked about national defense. Why would national defense provided by the government? Because it's a kind of public good, right? It's a kind of public good. So what is the definition of public good? You go to options B. So this is the definition of the public goods. And that's the answer. That's the answer. But only 40% of students, they can make it, okay? Now think about, the same report highlighted a lot of students pick option D. They thought that the private sector would charge a high price for national defense. No, you can see in the real world, right? No, okay, no way. Now, this question tests this ability of student to understand the meaning of consumer price index, okay? So consumer price index is the index to reflect, okay, the cost, okay, of, okay, the buying those consumer goods, okay? The cost of the consumer goods, the price level of the consumer goods only, okay? Not producer goods, okay? So, think about it, there is a drop, right? There's a drop, okay? So the cost of the consumer goods drop, then option C is the answer. But a lot of candidates, okay, they cannot pick the correct answer. Say for example, they misunderstand that it's about inflation, okay? They misunderstand it's about inflation. No, think about it. For inflation, it would consist of both, okay, think about it. You have to consist of both consumer goods and producer goods to compare, you know, the inflation rate. Okay, without the changes of the price level of the producer goods, okay, inflation cannot be compared in this question. So the answer must be C. This is the last question for this paper one. Now this question shows the range of inflation with three positive ones, okay, and one negative. It asks about the real value of money. Now, this is a very, very straightforward question, I would say. Because, think about it, there is an inverse relationship between inflation and real money. That means if inflation is positive, then the real value would drop. Now, on the other hand, if the inflation is negative, then the real value would raise. So it's very simple. It's all about the relationship between inflation and real value. Okay, the relationship is inverse relationship. Okay, so that's why. Okay, that's why the answer will go to D. Okay. Because there is deflation. This is called deflation. Okay, that's deflation. Now, for option A, we call it inflation. Now, for option B and C, we call them disinflation. But still, for disinflation, the real value will drop. Okay, for both inflation and disinflation, the real value of money will drop. Okay, be careful, because okay, it's a very straightforward question, but still. A lot of candidates, okay, they picked the wrong option. Right now, we are going to start with the paper 3. Paper 3, okay, so it's for A-level students only. So if you took the AS level, okay, you might just skip this part, okay. Right now, we will first of all take a look at a question related to the budget now, okay. So how to deal with this kind of question is that it's very easy. Now, the question stressed on the consumption patterns, okay, available to the group. Now, one of the skills to do it is to figure it out outside the budget now. Now, if that pawn is outside the budget now, then it won't be available to her. Okay, to be clear, that is point F. And point K. Point F and point K, they are outside the budget now. Okay, they're outside the budget now. So these okay, are not the the answers. Okay. So I would say option A and option B, okay, they're wrong. Okay, right now the lies on C or D, okay. The thing about the differences between C or D lies on the option H. So option H is inside the budget now, okay. So indeed, it would be possible. Of course, okay, the resources utilization might not be maximized, but still, it is possible, right? So that's why the answer goes to D. Well, only 27% of candidates, they can answer this question correctly. Now, this question asks for let me put it this way. This question tests the ability of students. Do they understand the total cost curve? The total cost. So what is the meaning of total cost? It would equal to the total fixed cost plus the total variable cost. So right now I would like to ask a question, okay, how to differentiate them? So what is total fixed cost? In this diagram, what is the total variable cost in this diagram? Figure it out. How to do that? You have learned, right? The differences between the total cost curve at the zero point. Okay, can you see that here? The total differences between the cost curve at zero point. This one represent the fixed cost. This one represent the fixed cost. The total fixed cost, right? Okay, so if you ignore this one, then you grab the wrong answer. As you can see, there are 40% of students, they pick option B. They thought that, okay, from the origin and put the curve, then you grab the average variable cost. It must be wrong. What you grab is the average total cost instead of the average variable cost. Okay, now be careful, okay. If you do it like this, okay, for OQ2, okay, represent the average total cost, okay. It's not the average variable cost. Now, if you want to find out the average variable cost, you have to draw the point, okay, from here. Okay, starting from here. Then the angle, okay, the angle will represent the average variable cost, the angle. Okay, so that's why, a lot of students, especially option B, okay, they pick a lot of option B, okay. So how about option A? Why option A would be the answer? So you might refer to the next video talking about another multiple choice question. Coming up, okay, it's coming up with another question also stressed on the average total cost. Okay, let's take a look. This question regards to the topic of the cost curve. So candidate, okay, must understand, okay, these concepts, or let me put it this way, you must know how to draw the cost curve, okay? You must know how to draw the cost curve. Now for option A, it must be wrong. But still, okay, 15% of candidates chose this one. Now the average fixed cost equal to the total fixed cost over quantity, as long as the denominator remains unchanged. And when the firm increased the output, think about it. The ATC must drop, okay? It won't rise, okay? It must drop at a decreasing rate, okay? Now, so that's why option A must be wrong, but still 15% of candidates pick this, okay? That means, okay, they do not know how to draw the cost curve, okay? So if you have difficulties in this part, okay, you must revise this topic, okay, very well. Now, I would like to go to option B. Now, option B, okay, there are 46% of students pick this. It must be wrong because the law of DMR relates to marginal cost, rather than the average variable cost. So this one is not that difficult because by definition, okay, the law of diminishing marginal returns is related to marginal cost, okay, rather than the AVC, the average variable cost, okay, it's wrong. Okay, so let's go to option D, okay, option D. Now option D is also wrong. Think about it. In a standard diagram, the marginal cost will fall first and then rise, okay? So that's why option D is also wrong. Now the answer lies on option C, okay? Now think about it, the average variable cost would be like this. Right, the average variable cost, the minimum point. Think about it, when the output increase. First of all, okay, the AVC might be greater than the ATC. Now, as long as the output increases, okay, the ATC, okay, must be lower than the AVC, okay, when the firm produces a great level of output, okay. As you can see, right, okay, in this formula, okay, the denominator remains unchanged. When there is an increase in output, the ATC must drop. Now, this question is about the demand for labor. But a lot of candidates mistaken that it's related to the supply of labor. Okay, so option C is not the answer, okay, because it relates to the supply of labor rather than the demand for labor. That's why a lot of candidates, okay, they chose option C, okay? So you have to think carefully, okay? So what is demand for labor? Demand for labor, indeed, is the derived demand. It's the derived demand of the demand for products, okay? Think about it, okay? Or we may say, okay, the demand for labor. Labor is a kind of factor of production. That's why it is the derived demand of the products. Okay? So when we take a look at this question, we have to be very careful. Okay? It's not about the supply of labor. That's why option D is also wrong, because it's related to the supply of labor. That's why the answers would go to option A, that is related to the budget changes, okay, to the budget changes. So that's it for this question 17. Here we go, the last question of this series. This question stressed on the topic of developed countries and developing countries. The relationship between them, okay, is in the last unit of the AL economic syllabus. And usually students, okay, might not put, okay, equity term to do the revision for this question. So let's take a look, the option one by one. Option A talks about the resources exploration will be banned. Okay, that means the resources owned by these developing countries would drop. Now, of course, simply, option A must not be the answer. But still, 18% of students would choose, they chose this option, okay. Why would that be, okay? Because, okay, I guess, these students might think that the ban on resources exploration, okay, would improve the environment. But still, you have to take a look at the question very carefully, okay? It's talking about the most beneficial, okay? So we have to take a look at the options, okay, before we go to option A. Now, option B talks about a restriction on the investment of the global firms. Simply, it's not the answer because the job opportunities brought by these firms would drop. So option B, again, must not be the answer. Still, 6% of candidates pick this option. Okay, they might think that because of the investment, the price level might increase. Okay, they might think in that way, but I personally think that, okay, the job opportunities drop. Okay, so this must not be the answer, okay? Now, option C, it talks about, okay, removal on the restrictions of the skilled labor. That means the skilled labor, they may leave the countries, their home countries, and go to the developed countries like the US to earn money. Now 27% of option, okay, they pick it, okay. My guess is they might think that these people, they can earn money. I guess these people can earn money and send back to home countries, okay. So that's why some candidates pick this option. Okay, this is my guess. Now, from the exam report, okay, they have another angle. The examiner thought, okay, the candidates, they, you know, confused about direction. Okay, that means they confused the direction about, okay, so they confused the meaning of immigration and migration, and that's why they pick option C. But indeed, think about skilled labor might, okay, immigrate to other countries, the long run AS curve will shift to the left, right? So the potential output would drop. The potential output would drop. So that's why option C, okay, must not be the answer. The answer lies on option D. Now, option D talks about the withdrawal of the subsidies in developed countries. Okay, that means think about it. The price competitiveness of the products from developing countries would increase, right? Would increase. Okay. Now, if you want to do it in economic sense, okay, that means the demand for the products, okay, from the developing countries would increase. So they would earn more revenue, okay? They would earn more revenue. So if you want to do it in economic sense, we'll do it this way. So the answer lies on option D, okay? But only less than half of the candidates, they can pick these options. Okay, now that's all for this video.